Thank you very much, Anirban. Welcome to all the participants today, and also to our distinguished speaker, Anirban Ghosh. Today is the 21st session of Analytics Wednesday. And today's topic is a journey towards automation with data analytics and bots in finance. So it's a little different topic. Very good topic for every corporate, for any organization, because finance function is a key to most of the organizations, whether in the private sector, government sector, or even NGOs. So very important to automate the repetitive tasks to ensure accuracy, to ensure that, you know, nothing goes amiss, and use the resources for more analytical work. Use their gray cells. Now, Sama has been at the forefront. Sama Audit has been at the forefront in automation efforts for auditors, for statutory auditors now with their working papers. I'm not going to talk about that. And this program is supported by Government of Canada Trade Commissioner Service. Earlier, we used to hold physical programs. It was supported by the Trade Commissioner Service at the High Commission in Delhi, Canada. But now, because of the online, because of the pandemic and because of the online, you know, webinars, they have come forward to support this web series also, the webinar series also. Now, I'll formally introduce Anirban before I ask him to enlighten us on this topic. Now, he is a professional with 20 plus years of experience in this field. He's led and managed internal departments, risk management function, and also finance function of Indian and multinational companies. He's a postgraduate management degree holder from IIM Bangalore, Ahmedabad. And he's also a chartered certified accountant. He's a CPA, CFE, certified fraud examiner, and CISA, certified information systems auditor. Now, he wears two hats, as I said in the beginning. He's the global head for finance, shared services, and finance risk management for Wipro Limited. Now, he is responsible for driving operational excellence and digital transformation for payments processing at Wipro, covering key matrices around timeliness, quality, design, and risk management of operations of a large global team, covering team members from multiple geographies. As the head of finance risk management, he leads the second line of defense for the finance organization and works very closely in close cooperation with statutory auditors, global controller, general counsel, ERM, internal audit, and the CFO. He leads the global SOX compliance program for Wipro Limited, runs risk management reviews across various finance processes to drive enhancement of internal controls and process compliances, leads the program on automation through bots and DA for the Wipro finance controllership function. Key areas of expertise, of course, internal controls in global business operations, international subsidiaries, and post M&A evaluation of targets controls, assessment of compliance to key regulations, SOX, GDPR, FCPA, etc., evaluation and review of system implementations from controls perspective. So highly process focused and highly control focused. So I think we have Anirban. Anirban, over to you, please.
Thank you, Deepji. Thanks a lot for a wonderful introduction, and very glad to be participating in this webinar with all of you. Our association with Sama goes back many years, and earlier formats have been on physical format, but this is again interesting, and very happy to be part of this. Thanks for the invite. Also thanks to Jairam and others from Sama for inviting me. So I would like to also apologize if anyone had made an attempt to attend my last seminar, which we couldn't follow through because of network issues, but I'm very glad to be trying to do that today here. So let me get started. I have a presentation, Deepji. I'll probably start from there. So while we talk through, do let me know if it's visible.
Yes, absolutely. Fine.
Okay. All right. So good evening, everyone, and glad to be talking to all of you today. As Deepji briefly mentioned, I wear two hats, and I've also been part of internal audit at Wipro before. So some of the examples and whatever I'm going to talk through today will be from all three perspectives. What I've seen from internal audit, what I've done from a risk management standpoint as a second line of defense, and most recently when I've taken over additionally as a shared services head of finance, there what we are seeing from automation perspective. So that's how I've planned this session. The agenda, as I've laid out, you know, I want to speak on two broad themes. One being, you know, program managing a data analytics or an automation journey for an organization. Because I don't think when we do something on a very ad hoc basis, that gives us the best results. So I believe, and I've seen what has worked well for us, is running it as a program. So I want to share some experiences, particularly from that perspective, how we developed a program around it. Secondly, obviously, talking through the use cases, which will give you some ideas about what we have done based on what industries all of you are from, based on your roles. You may or may not find that relevant, but you may get some ideas of how we have looked at things. Since I come from an IT services background, a lot of some of those examples may be from that perspective, but I think most of us being auditors or finance professionals will understand. I want to spend some time, again, going back to the first theme about how as a program, one might come across challenges, one might need to know what are the key success factors. That's come over a period of time from my learning, because we've seen some failures also. Right, and all of us go through both the cycles. So I'll be happy to share some of that. And finally, I want to end with saying what next. So this is how I've laid out the agenda. And as we go, if I don't know what the format we want to follow, I'm okay with either questions being asked during the session or after. It's perfectly fine. So starting with this first slide where I'm talking about the vision. One may think that when I'm starting an audit, I don't start with a vision of data analytics or any of that. But here again, I'm coming back from a larger perspective. If I'm an internal auditor, or if I'm a finance controller, or if I'm any of the roles within finance today, we are not looking at data analytics as a one-off item. Today, everybody is in some shape and form is dealing with data analytics. So I don't think I'm talking something new to all of you. But then again, how the organization perceives some of these initiatives, some of the investments that go into these initiatives, that can differ from organization to organization, how depending on where the company is positioned in their mindset about using some of these technologies and also the approach. In that respect, I would say that I've been fortunate to be part of Wipro, which as an IT company ourselves, we are involved in a journey of transformation for many of our clients, right? That's what is our bread and butter job. However, beyond that, what I can also say is that, over the last 2-3 years, there's been a very significant, significant program around enhancing our finance processes across by really asking the question, can something be done better, with more efficiency, with more effectiveness within the finance function using technology. And therefore, for me, the journey of implementing some of these programs within Wipro has been to that extent easier, because the vision is coming from a higher level, including from the right from the CFO's office, right? And in that sense, given the kind of transformation that the organization itself is going through, I think it becomes easier for me. Simply said, the kind of automations that we are, the purpose that which we are looking at automation should be common to all of you, the way you think of it as well. Like, reducing human efforts, enhancing accuracy, efficiency. As auditors, we always want to increase the comprehensiveness of our work, not just relying on samples, but looking at population. From a shared service perspective, when I look at it, enabling touchless processes where there should not be any human being touching a transaction. Can it be done completely automated, right? So these are all different elements that we look at. But And you know, each of us as participants here, you may have some other reasons, but for us, these are the key reasons. And you know, the simple question that we are always asking is, does this process need to be done manually, opening three different screens, going through different process people, or can it be moved to a seamless process? And that's how I think the organization is viewing things. Therefore, you know, our journey also has been on those lines. Moving on, so, you know, some of the examples that I have decided to speak about today will be in the same thought process, right? There's going to be some examples that I'll talk about where, as an auditor or as a risk management professional, I have looked at enhancing audit efficiency and identification of risks, looking at better ways to find findings, which is a bread and butter job for any auditor, right? And then from an operations angle, I will talk about some of the automations that we've seen within controllership, we've implemented within the finance organization and the finance shared services, which has made our lives much more better, much more, and I'm not talking about life in terms of work-life balance. What I mean is that, you know, the comprehensiveness of our work, the accuracy levels, all of that has improved. Now, and this is where I think, you know, as if those who are auditors here, they should also go back and start asking this question as part of their audits when they pick up a process that, you know, why is this process manual? Why not automated or semi-automated? So I think that's the value that, you know, as auditors, we should start looking at if you're not already doing that. So that's how I'm going to talk through. So let me start with some of the examples from the audit perspective, right? Day one audit report. I think, you know, this is a dream come true for any auditor when you start an audit. Most of the times, if you say you have an audit plan, you know what you want to do. But typically what we end up with is data nahi hai. You know, we don't have the right data. You're chasing the IS or the IT guys. You're not getting the reports. Then you bring everything together, do the analysis. By then, even before that analysis, you've had a discussion with the management team whom you're auditing, right? And that conversation is typically about, you know, this is my ask. This is what I want to do as part of my coverage. You know, it's a very standard form of doing the audits. Now, what we did, and this is something that was done about 3-4 years back, is we said that, look, within our organization, we know there are certain business structures. We have SBUs, right? And each business unit will typically have same kind of issues, but we want to look at them. We can look at them at an account level. We have 1,000 plus customer accounts. So if we want to analyze those issues at a customer level, at a business level, at an SBU level, at a practice level, you know, different hierarchies can be built. How do we get that data every time and be ready on day one of the audit? And that was one of the first things that we decided that, you know, the purpose should be to enable very easy audit, you know, having the right kind of information on day one of your audit and not thinking about how do I get the data. And therefore, what we did is we built about 15 rules, which were common, and the data was set up in such a way we would get everything from a system into a certain place. And these rules were pre-configured. And, you know, it would be at any point in time we want to run the report, just give the period, data is available, right? So this is one of the things that we did. And the best part of this process was that, you know, every time we would pick up a different unit, on day one of our audit, we don't just go and talk to the user or the account head or the business head about what we want to do. We actually would have some of the analytics already done before. We would have some of the trends already available with us. I've given some examples of, you know, at a couple of things like billing or resource management. On these two aspects, which are, you know, employees, you can imagine from an IT company perspective is the biggest cost, right? So we want to look at this very closely. So for this, this particular rule set, which was developed with 60 different charts that were coming out from these 15 rules, would give us all kinds of analytics. And I can, you know, I didn't put on those slides, but broadly what this would help us is on day one, we have observations which are at least draft observations level ready. Of course, explanations have to come from the auditee, and we understand where the what is the reasons. They might have explanations, but this elevates the whole function and the discussion with some of the senior folks. And you also don't feel that level of stress that, you know, I've not yet got started. So I think this was one of the examples how efficiency in audit was enabled. And obviously you build consistency along with that. Every audit team, different teams, they all have the same data set depending on what they're covering. So this was one example from an internal audit perspective I wanted to share. Data Mart is another thing that we did to enable our efficiency of the audit process better. Again, going back to the same example, the first set of examples I gave you was very business-centric examples. Now, these are operational-centric examples, more with related to non-business, but maybe on the operations side, like purchase orders. I'm doing a S2P audit. Now, again, same challenge. You want to have ready-made data available to you when you want to start the audit. And we always realize that after beyond a point, when you want to go back and run reports, etc., we would end up, you know, either not having the data always ready, or you know, something or the other comes up. So what, again, the objective of the Data Mart was to ensure that all the data that we typically use in different kinds of audits are getting captured and stored in a particular repository. And on a monthly basis, we keep adding. And we actually had a process where these data would keep getting stored. So we were never at a problem of getting the data at the time when we wanted to start. So in fact, now what I know, I have not seen it myself, but what I understand from my team in internal audit is they have taken this to a next level where they have also ensured that, you know, all this data, many of which is, you know, which is privacy oriented, payroll data or some of this, how do you get anonymization done very quickly? So they have actually implemented an automation within this data, which anonymizes all the records very quickly. So therefore you don't have a risk of data privacy or other kind of things. So these are some of the examples that I could think of. Of course, I can talk through many examples in on, you know, what is the tests that we did, but I think broadly the idea was to, you know, as a program, when you look at, these are some of the basic challenges that you don't want to deal with when you start. So I thought these are a couple of good examples to share from a process perspective. Coming to the some of the examples in terms of the role as a controller or as a second line of defense. Well, you know, one of the things that I have seen, and many of you in your companies will have, is that in the controllership organization, there will be a certain set of items or risks or exceptions that you would have built that you don't want things going wrong in those aspects, right? So I have given a few examples here. These are, you know, I obviously could not put up all the examples, but in controllership in Wipro, what we had is a weekly dashboard being prepared manually by people who would look for some of these anomalies. And we call them as exceptions or risks. Exceptions where it is not supposed to happen, but if someone is doing it or there's a lack of system control and we want to catch, is the exception really going beyond the numbers that we expect within the tolerance limit? All of this was being done manually, outsourced to a third party. One of the things that we did here is we implemented bots to you know, automate this entire process. And what that does, therefore, is we've implemented bots that has the rules which will go and look for each of these items. So when we say changes made in local currency amount by checker while posting, so there is obviously a data that is coming from SAP. We have a rule that is built in which will go and look for this particular, if there is change in the change log, whether there's a change that has happened, and that gets picked up. And like this, you know, the rules are not really important for this discussion. What I'm trying to emphasize is the frequency in which this had to be done, and some of the, you know, the challenges that we had with running these analytics at a manual level was massive, because every time you would run some of these data points, it is not you know, hundreds of a thousand lines. These run into lakhs and lakhs, and that is where we typically look at automation. So that was one of the things we, you know, people told us that a system would crash frequently, segregating the queries would be a problem every time. And so all of this has got completely automated. We run around 15 plus 20, around 35 rules we have, which run on a weekly basis. All at the click of a button, these, you know, the data moves from SAP directly into this particular storage from where the rules get triggered. We get the outcome. And then, in fact, one of the things that we also eliminated in this whole process is user level information that would get captured. Who is the user who has defaulted? Mails had to be manually sent, right? So we have automated even that. Every email that has to be sent to the user, including whether the person has read or not, we would get replied or not, we would get a report done. So this actually eliminated the whole manual activity of doing something which absolutely doesn't give us any value. What we therefore started focusing, obviously one was the external help that we were taking, that cost would be completely saved. We didn't have to do this externally. Manually, the team that is doing this under you know, my group, they simply have to run the reports, get them, you know, once the triggers happen, just follow up, understand what the problems are, what was the reason for exception. And from there, we take it ahead with in terms of reporting. So the focus is a lot more on understanding the issues and is there something that is going wrong beyond, you know, the tolerance limit. And obviously, what can be done about certain failures if they are happening repeatedly, either at a personal level or at a process level, right? So these are, this is a, I would say, a great example of automation that within the controllership organization we've implemented. Obviously, the same thing I've also done in my shared services operation. There again, we have a set of you know, exceptions that have been defined, risks that have been defined. And again, it was the same story where people were running the reports, doing the whole process manually, extracting the data, identifying the exceptions. All of that is now being run by bots. So it makes life a lot more, you know, simpler, and you spend a lot more quality time doing, you know, looking at the analysis of the work rather than just extracting dumps. So this is an example. On the risk management side, from the share, from a FRM standpoint, these are again some of the automations that we have done on the S2P side. Again, many of you might be doing some of these examples, but again, from a risk management framework perspective, what we have done is we've identified, let's say, S2P as a key area. What are the exceptions that you know, we would like to catch early? So as you can see, some examples like one-time vendor. Typically, we don't want one-time vendor transactions happening at all, because then the process of that vendor setup is very different. The controls applied are very different. So those are very unique cases where we just want to have a one-time transaction with a vendor and it's created. We said we don't want to have this too often. We want to look across all entities. You know, we have 100 plus subsidiaries. We want to look at where this is happening. Is it happening too frequently? So therefore, the data was codified, the rules were codified, and we start getting the outcome. Non-PO spend analysis. One of the things that, you know, in a service PO, which many of you will understand, unlike inventory or, you know, goods, where you have actually a acceptance and there's something to look at materially. Here, in non-service, non-PO services, we typically have a problem where the purchase order itself is not available. Therefore, it becomes a lot more easier for someone to, you know, if they intend to beat the systems, they can always play around in this area. And therefore, there's a lot of focus on this. By default, we've, as a process, like function, as a functional side, there are fairly strict guidelines on when you should have PO versus non-PO. I mean, those are policy level decisions that anyway we will drive. But then we also wanted to make sure that, you know, is someone still trying to play with the system? So some of the analytics that have been built are to see whether somebody is having both a PO and a non-PO, for example. Now, getting that data, analyzing, doing the repetitive activity every time has been completely eliminated. We just have a rule that runs, gives us this output, and we know where there's any kind of incremental change from what has been done in the past. Benford's Law test, you know, I think, again, very familiar with people who have who come from audit background or fraud analytics background. It's an analysis of transactions based on digits. IDEA Analytics provides this as a feature. Most of the leading tools have this feature enabled, where based on, let's say you're looking at invoice numbering conventions. The rule is built in such a way that, you know, the statistical possibility of transactions starting with one or two or three. There is a set of rules that governs what should normally be expected. And therefore, when we run this test, if something is going out of what the rule suggests, which is a statistical possibility, then we look into that. So again, I'm not claiming that we found a huge amount of frauds here or any of that, but again, this is one of the nice rules that we've put in place, which helps us to look at transactions very differently, which manually we could not have picked up. This is where the technology really comes into play. There's a huge advantage to look at patterns of data, which probably as a human being will not catch. Other tests that I've mentioned, like vendor bank data analysis, how frequently is a bank number of the vendor changing, expedited transactions, same day purchase order created, approved, invoice, everything done within a very short time. Again, these are risk indicators, need not be anything wrong, but we get very quickly the outcome, and then we put a periodicity of testing around all this, and that helps us analyze the data, right? So these are some of the examples I thought I should share with all of you in the on the risk management side. I have not paused for any questions, Deepji. Should I do that now or we continue?
I think we can take all the questions at the end, Anirban.
Okay.
Or if there are questions now, I don't mind, but better you can take everything at the end.
Sure. Sounds good. Okay. So this was, some of the examples I wanted to quote from both the risk side and as well as the, the audit side that we've seen. Obviously, there have been a lot of other examples, but, obviously I didn't want to put everything here. But it's more about sharing the idea around how we look at data and how we're trying to make this smarter. Coming to some examples on enhancing the efficiency of operations. Now, this is where I'm stepping out from the auditor hat, but looking at things, what we've done on the automation side within controllership and, some of the related functions. And again, I've put in some of the examples here. But what we've done is we've set up a center of excellence within the group, within controllership, where all the leaders within the controllership function, leading different areas, we get together. We've identified a set of activities that we see our team members performing regularly. Again, it's another form of audit, but they do it as part of either their transactions or as part of their audit. And then they have to park transactions, they have to post transactions into SAP based on the outcome, right? So on the banking side, we've come up with a number of bots, which basically is simple as, identifying what are the bank charges, asking a consolidated entry for the bank charges account. Sweep in, sweep out of transactions. The transactions happened, now you have to pass the parking entry. Intercurrent subsidiaries. So a lot of, and I don't want to spend too much time about each of the scenario here, but the point is, what we've done is, everywhere where we see that there's a manual activity happening, we are asking the question, can this activity be done faster by automation? And we are finding surprisingly a lot of examples where it can be done. So also, I didn't touch upon this earlier, but we are fortunate that within Wipro, we have a analytics group itself on the technology front who helps us to implement these rules, who represent the artificial intelligence group within Wipro. And we've tied up with them to run some of these projects. And we've been running this program now for more than a year. Fortnightly discussions happen and we go through each of these activities. Let me show you some more examples on the treasury front, what we've done. For example, deals entered in SAP will be validated against the emails that come through, whether the facts have been picked up correctly. And then there are a host of other transactions here that are mentioned, you know, fixed asset register, for example, finding out the asset descriptions sometimes are not very clear, and therefore classifying the assets based on the descriptions, based on rules that have been set up. We've given a call out, if it is so-and-so, then it is this. If it is so-and-so, so the entire fixed assets get analyzed based on that criteria, and then, you know, the output comes out. So GST is, again, a great example. Here, we were looking at vendor invoices, and we wanted to make sure that, you know, the details are captured as per the invoice to what is, you know, accounted in SAP. And here, interestingly, there's a certain population of vendor invoices which have been, which are processed through one system called Synergy that is called out here, where the formats are same. The invoice format is always same because that's worked out with the vendors. So there, it's very easy to analyze the data. What is there? It's very easy to train the system to say, okay, the GST field always comes in a certain place. And therefore, we've trained that system through automation, and that now picks out. So what was being audited by the GST team to verify on a very sample basis, now that entire activity is happening 100% check, whether there's any mismatches. So again, you know, there are a few other examples, but broadly the story is the same. We've cut across different aspects of controllership, and still there are a lot of projects going on within controllership where we are trying to look at what can be done through automation, and therefore then it is just about running the reports, getting the output, and then posting the entries. There's also an element of risk, and therefore we make sure that, you know, the rules are validated with a, you know, the black box approach that we've all studied, right? You look at the output by doing it manually, you look at the output through system, whether it's working, logic is working fine. In fact, this is one of the things that is now becoming more and more prevalent with the auditors, where if a control is being exercised or performed by an automated bot or something like that, then the auditors also want to understand whether the bot itself is working fine or not. I'm sure many of you have been part of such discussions wherever there is automation happening. And so there again, there's a process that has been laid out, you know, having the business requirement document, the BRDs in place, making sure the approvals are there, making sure that everything is evidenceable, the codes that has been developed, and, you know, making sure that the output that is coming out is stored in a particular folder to show the entire end-to-end process, so that tomorrow if an auditor comes and asks you that, you know, show me, how do I know that the calculation that you've done is right or wrong? We have evidence to show that. So I think broadly, this is what, you know, I wanted to cover from my controllership experience. The last 10 minutes, maybe I will speak through some of the automations that we've seen on our shared services. Shared services, the dynamics are very different, as many of you understand. This is not, we are not running a shared service for customers. This is shared service for Wipro finance organization. We are running the whole accounts payable process, collection accounting, BRS, GL scrutiny, GL recons, and few other processes, right? So here, when we look at automation, and we've seen a huge transformation in the shared service over, even before me, my predecessors have been involved in that, is making sure that, you know, how can you optimize your headcount in a shared service environment? You obviously want to make sure that your shared service is known to be a centralized activity. You want to make sure that only the right number of people are working. You have the right level of balance within the organization, but you're not overdoing things because things are streamlined. Things can be streamlined, right? So there's been a lot of automation around our shared service organization, and we've seen benefits on two, three angles. One, obviously on the headcount, while I can't disclose how the numbers have moved, but we see a fairly good amount of reduction in headcount simply by automating processes and redeploying those headcounts in other activities, right? So that's been one of the focuses. Enhancing employee experience is where I'm going to talk about a couple of examples. It is not just employee experience, but I'll also talk about the vendor's experience, what we've enabled. Let me talk through these examples and what we've done. So for example, one of the things that we've always handled from a shared service operations for payments is when somebody calls us and says, why is my payment not done? Where is my payment? What is the status of this invoice? Now we get this at two levels. One, the user, the purchase, the group that has placed the request for purchase, we call them the user group. They can ask this question, or the suppliers themselves ask this question. So now we've developed a chatbot on both these aspects, where the chatbot helps users to log into a website. Predefined set of questions are populated there. User, we know the kind of questions that come either from the user, which is internal or external. And people simply go into the chatbot, they fill in the details, and all the responses are available instantly. So you just provide your purchase order number, you provide your invoice number, and there are various other choices that are given. And based on that, the system pulls out the data. Again, what we have done is we've eliminated, it's not just about removing people from the process, but also eliminating that whole waiting time where somebody is looking for an answer, you don't know where things are. That entire activity has now got automated. There has been automation in the BRS front, which is one of the activities that my team does. We have around 400 plus BRSs to be prepared in a monthly basis and number of times in a month, right? So there again, the next slide, I'll talk through some of the what we've done in the BRS front, but entire matching of it, of the transactions in BRS has been automated, and we are getting a fairly good percentage of straight match. I'm not saying we get 100% match, but straight match is there about 70-80% of the time. And then the balance is what the team works on. Again, there the advantage has been that we've what we could do once or twice, now we are doing it more frequently. As and when we keep acquiring new and newer entities into our company, we are trying to put them into this process, and therefore the integration becomes much more easier and faster. OCR is again one of the things that we've tried to do, where we train our vendor invoices on the basis of the vendor's format. The invoices get trained into our system, and through OCR technology, we simply are trying to pick up the information so that at an agent level, you don't even have to make the entry. Again, it is prone to errors sometimes, and we've got processes in place to make sure that there are no errors. It goes through a training process, as I told you. Effectively, what we've been able to do is eliminate a lot of manual errors in the process with the OCR technology. I have not covered here some of our automation that has happened on the reporting front. But in a shared service environment, you can imagine every transaction needs to be analyzed from the point of view of accuracy, from the point of view of timeliness. And therefore, for my supervisors in the team, for my managers in the team, for them to know what is priority today, which invoices are high priority, which one is running late, how many transactions have been processed today at an agent level, what is the level of processing accurate speed, how many transactions is somebody doing versus somebody else. You can imagine I run a 250 people team here, and getting that kind of data every day to make sure that we are targeting the right set of transactions, to make sure that we are targeting, we are enhancing our oversight on people, especially in an environment like pandemic where people are not even in front of you, right? They're all working from their home. So maintaining that balance of performance, all of that, a lot of that is going through our automated reports that come out of our of all our systems. And therefore, the oversight becomes much more smarter. Here you see 2001 and beyond, some of the examples that are given. All of this has already, most of it has got implemented by now, where these are again a typical Wipro terminology, so I'll not spend too much time, but we have the PO based and non-PO based invoices. Earlier, there were too many touch points all of that has been now to the, a lot of it has been eliminated, and we are trying to do, you know, the goal is zero touch process. We've not achieved it, but we are very close, right? And then again, as I spoke about earlier, we are also trying to, you know, the RPA that I've mentioned here as an example, the posting of transactions to make it touchless. There is a transactional activity that happens, which is also now happening through RPA. So not all my invoices are automated this way, but a significant portion of it has got done. So these are some of the, you know, the examples that I thought from a shared service point of view I can share. BRS I spoke to you about earlier. Again, this slide just talks a little bit more detail about what how that whole activity happens, and possibly many other organizations are also doing this same thing. But if your organization is not doing it, and you know, if you see value in it, either as an auditor or as a finance manager, please look into these options, right? So these are, I think, some of the pointers that I had in terms of what we have done. Chatbot I spoke about earlier, it has really enhanced our experience, user experience, and obviously productivity has also evolved. I'll not spend more time on this. Last couple of slides before we go into question and answers. Over this journey, you know, today, in fact, I just completed 5 years today in Wipro. I have had, I've seen some bit of success as well as some bit of challenges and things that have not worked in this whole journey of automation. And typically, you know, some of the key ones that I thought will be there and which we'll have to always deal with are things like IT issues, right? We will have everything in ready. There's right intent, there's investment ready, but sometimes you just don't have the support from the IT side. And therefore, there's a need for that level of sponsorship. And this is where I'm talking more from a program managing perspective, where you need the right sponsorship to make sure that you have support. Otherwise, things can get derailed. Second point, inability to get right set of people together. You know, so I have seen stages where we've tried to do things as a small group, trying to change the world, right? And honestly, while right intent, but if you don't have, again, the right set of people, not just from IT side, but from user side, sometimes you will not end up with the right kind of output. I remember an example where we had built a set of rule sets and everything, and then, you know, we went back and showed it to one of the business users. And he said, but why did you do all this? We already do this in a different way, and I could have given you this data very quickly. So getting the right set of people to drive your program around automation is very important, because that's when you get, you know, it becomes something that you have everyone's interest in, and therefore, you know, collective energy. Third point, I think most auditors, if you are starting out, you will see, you know, you go and buy a tool like IDEA or one of the other tools. And after implementation, initial 2 months, there's a lot of excitement, and then people slowly start going away and say that, you know what, Excel was easier. Again, it's very important to therefore get people excited by doing the right kind of analytics. So if you're just going to do simple stuff which Excel can provide, obviously it's a no-brainer that you should stick to Excel. But there are so many beautiful features that most of these audit tools carry with you. I like one of the two features in IDEA, for example, which is called field statistics, right? In one click, you get so much information about that data that you're looking at, right from, you know, what is the count of the transactions to how many transactions happened on a Saturday, how many happened on a Sunday. All these are pre-set. So there's so much that can be done. But I have had to deal with this problem of, you know, I would rather stick to Excel, right? So this is one of the things that we have to always be aware of, and, you know, make sure that we have the right kind of training to people. Point number four, again, making grandiose plans. I think, you know, while on one side we say that don't stick to very basic stuff, but again, don't overdo things where you plan such big things that, you know, you are not able to take off at all. And that has also happened as an experience, and therefore I've put it as a point that, you know, it's always good to make incremental progress, but you make it consistently. So some of these projects that you take up should be balanced to that extent that yes, it is achievable, and you will get quick results, and it's not something that you're building for the next 6 months, 8 months. And therefore, the point number five, again, inability to maintain momentum, all tied to all of this, right? You start off with a big bang and then eventually you lose pace. So these are some of the common derailers, and which is why some of the top takeaways for me, which I have called out are, setting up a COE structure, having the right kind of investments in place, making sure you get the senior management excited about things. I've not mentioned here, but while we do all this, there is a basic step of human intelligence that should not go away. Sometimes we end up with a lot of all this, and then there are some basic checks that one should have done that has gone away. And, CFO might just tell that you're talking about all this, but, the basic check hasn't happened. So that obviously you balance, we all have to balance as auditors or as finance professionals. Building momentum through quick wins and low hanging fruits. Yes, this is good for making sure that people remain engaged. And third, don't get too think about a certain tool, whether it should be R, whether it should be Tableau, whether it should be BI, Power BI, any of these tools work, right? Or it could be a combination. Like in our case, we have had all kinds. We have our own AI tool for Wipro, but on many occasions, we've tried other tools as well, including IDEA that we use. And depends on what is the right tool to be used where, we just make those decisions, right? So I think these are some of the key pointers that, as in terms of learnings, I thought I'd share. And while I said that, we should look at low-hanging fruits, there's obviously this element of having a plan to move to the next level. And that's where, you hear things like machine learning and NLP, computer vision. I mean, these names sound very tricky, but if you talk to some of the people who are doing it, it's not always that complicated. You just need a set of people who have the right skills to come and build it for you. So for example, today I have a duplicate payment transactions verification process in my, my shared service environment. Can I use machine learning to predict which vendor seems to always have problem and therefore I need to be more careful? Very simple. It will just analyze patterns and it will tell you that, yes, be careful about these vendors. Can you have a automation to say that, all right, this particular vendor always submits invoices in the range of between 10 to 30,000. Now, suddenly you have an invoice which is of, say, take a value of 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs. Is that really consistent with that vendor's, history and, transaction pattern? No. And that's where some of these analytics can be built to make your audit work, your thing much more smarter. So therefore, machine learning, computer vision, as I spoke about as an example, is nothing but chatbot, right? Or natural language processing is chatbot, my apologies. Computer vision is something where, the OCR technology that we spoke about, where you look at the document gets screened and you configure the document to read out. And again, I know this is possible in IDEA through the PDF reader. At least there's one feature that is there. Many other tools will have this, where you just need to know the right right logic to be built in if you have a consistent data and you can do it. And of course, there are a lot more advancements that is possible, and which is where I say that, these are things which we, take ahead and we don't stop. So the journey doesn't stop here. The journey continues, and, at least we are trying to do more and more. And hopefully next time I speak again with all of you here, I'll have some more good examples. So I think with that, I'll take a pause, Deepji. I'm fairly, concluded. We have about 10 minutes. So if there are any questions, I'm happy to take.
Thank you very much, Anirban. Wonderful. I think it looked very simple, but I am right now working with a company, I am an advisor on their board and I'm working with them to automate their finance process. So I know how much of effort is required to get this done, to put teams together, to understand the process, to understand what should be automated, what are the key controls, what technology should be employed, whether you do it within your SAP system itself, whether you employ some bots, how do you go about doing it, and then perfect it over a period of time to ensure that it is error free. So sounds very simple in this presentation of 50-60 minutes you talked about, but a lot of pain, but there is a lot of pleasure at the end of it, because you a lot of gain out of it, because that's how you progress, and that is the way forward for any finance function today. Any questions, please? Very enlightening session. I particularly enjoyed it a lot. If there are no questions, then we can call it a day today. I want to thank Anirban for, you know, being with us, for sparing his valuable time, staying back in office so that, you know, we can have this session from him, and also immediately agreeing when I called him, you know, that why don't we do this session, and he immediately agreed. In the past, we have had him physically for our workshops in Bombay, for our conferences in Bombay. All the best to you, Anirban, for all the learnings that you have shared with us, and also for all the work that you have been doing in the company that you're working right now. So with that, I'll call it a day, and thank you very much for all the participants who have joined us today. Look forward to next week, another session on Analytics Wednesday. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, Anirban. Thanks a lot to all the participants. Good night.
Bye.
Bye.
Anirban, thank you.